So we're back. Where were we?
Oh, we haven't talked about Huntley Community Radio.
No, well, I know we're going to get there. We just wanted to hear a little bit about your background. I got one more question for you, though. I'm curious. What's your personal favorite medium, TV or radio? Just curious.
I guess these days I like radio.
Do you?
I do. I
Theater
really
of the mind, better than the TV?
Yeah, I like this, the discussion shows. But I like both, and I like film. I like anything that's communicating.
You know, you two have very strong backgrounds. You really do. And to have taken on this ambitious venture, briefly, who wants to answer? I'm sure you do, Alan. What is Huntley Community Radio, really?
Okay, well, Huntley Community Radio, officially, legally, is a 501c3 Illinois non-for-profit corporation. We are going to focus on, again, as I indicated earlier, on the interests and the needs of the Huntley Radio.
What kind of programming? What kind of programming?
Okay, we're gonna actually have three phases to our program. We're gonna be broadcasting 24 hours a day, 365 days a year.
Jeez,
and somebody would say, isn't it an ambitious effort on your part as a startup? And the answer is absolutely. Absolutely. So we're going to break it down into three areas. The first is going to be our prime hours, which is going to be from 6 in the morning to 6 in the evening. And that's the time we're going to be broadcasting local news, weather, sports, and then we're going to have call-in programs, much like you have at this station. And they're going to, so there's going to be an opportunity for the community to interact with programs that are going to be of particular interest to them, such as programs in health, education, recreation, and so on. The civic organizations within the community explaining things that they do and offer with to our community at large. And there's going to be an opportunity among the listeners to call in and ask questions of the experts and those who are going to be coming and representing those kinds of programming. And so that's going to happen during this prime period. In addition, as the opportunity arises, we're going to not only do in-studio broadcasts, but we are going to offer remote broadcasts. So we're going to be going to special events, going to the high schools and do play-by-plays of their basketball games and their football games and so on. About 45 minutes.
Will they get your? They won't get your signal.
No, not the only way that you're going to hear it is going to be through the internet radio.
Because I'm friends with girls who are Rockford Rage Roller Derby.
Is that right?
And wouldn't that be fun to announce one of their bouts on a Saturday night when they have a really good
bout? Well, you know, certainly to encourage others to go out to that location to watch them perform, to watch them do that. You know, I'll just talk about a little bit about the about internet radio as versus the low-powered FM, and just very, very briefly about that. Internet radio is what we're going to start with. We're going to be able to control that, and we have sufficient funds right now to actually begin to purchase the equipment and the studio to house that equipment to be able to start our broadcast on the internet. As I said, we can control that, and we're hoping that with the sufficient volunteers and additional funding in order to be able to maintain our operating costs, that we'll be able to start by the end of the spring.
Let me ask you something. It seems like a very costly venture for your station. How and why? Where are you getting the money?
Okay.
And how much about does it cost to start up an internet radio thing?
Okay. Well, we're talking about $25,000 to purchase the equipment that's necessary, and start the operating operating costs for the internet radio. And we know this is the case because we have on our executive among board of directors our technical advisor who is currently the chief engineer of WGN Radio. He serves in that capacity to let us know what our technical requirements are going to be. So we do know what equipment we're going to need, where we're going to be purchasing it, and how much it's going to cost. So we're anticipating about that cost. We do have a budget we have proposed to through the end of the year. It's a little ambitious on our part to try to gain this. $100,000.
By the end of 12?
By the end of
2012?
Yes, by the end of 2012. But that now is going to be focused. Now we're going to go to offer the low-powered FM.
So now 25,000 to do the internet and another 75,000 to do the low-powered FM.
Well, we're really talking about another $40,000, $45,000 for the equipment requirement and for the tower. That's it. So the tower, the antenna, the transmitter, those additional equipment requirements, and obviously the installation of the tower and so mm-hmm. on, that's going to be required. And then we've got about $25,000 for the ongoing operations through the end of 2012.
But is it all going to be pretty much volunteer based?
It's going to be all volunteer except for our station manager, which if there's a sufficient funding. It would be an opportunity for somebody, say, at Elgin Community College that is going through their broadcasting curriculum and they want to start an internship with us. And then at some point, it'll be a salaried position to be able to be there because we're going to have somebody who is employed by us that's going to serve in a full-time position so that they would be able to manage the day-to-day operations and coordinate the schedules of our volunteers.
Sure, and there's a lot of stuff that goes on and people don't really realize
Absolutely.
It. Just with this, my one-hour show a week, yeah. 57 minutes, if you will. Mm-hmm. It takes a tremendous amount of prep, right. And, I mean, you know, I put a lot into it. George always says I'm over-prepared, but
right.
So do that times 24
yeah. Right. Now, there's
hours.
I want to point out that we, as I said, we have control over our internet. FCC, however, has control over our low-powered FM. And a low-powered FM radio was available to us in 2000. There's about 700 or so stations that are currently licensed for low-powered stations.
No, and do they all – low-power means it's just going to go like 3 to 4 miles out from the base?
That's right. And actually, I've heard some low-powered stations are – you know, it's if you're in your car or if the frequency is not being interrupted by other that are trying to vie for that, for the area, that are in areas where its signal becomes weak, it may go out 10 miles. You
okay.
may be able to hear that. Again, it's radial distance from the antenna.
Okay, and I just want to say one thing, that you're listening to the Laura Dion Jones Show, and we're on the air with Alan Pollack, Executive Director and Founder of Huntley Community Radio, and Dorothy Litwin, one of Chicagoland TV and radio's foremost pioneers in the biz. Back to the tower now. Goes out 10 miles, if you're lucky, on a sunny day, right?
That's correct. So it really, that would cover certainly all of the Huntley area, because the tower is going to be centrally located within Huntley. We already know the location that is going to be placed. But what has to happen here is that, let me back up here. In December of 2010, Congress finally enacted a new law that allows for the continuation of low-powered FM stations. There was a suspension since 2006 to that point in time because there was some concern there was going to be interference with other broadcast entities, and they needed to investigate that. Ultimately, it was determined it was unwarranted to go through that study. But in any case, we now waiting to get an open window.
Here's my window.
Your window.
You're listening to the Laura Dion Jones Show. We're on the air with Alan Pollack, Executive Director and passionate founder of Huntley Community Radio, and Dorothy Litwin, the maven of Chicagoland TV and radio pioneer days. Tell me something. I'm going to switch gears a little bit here on you now. What is your biggest challenge moving forward? What do you think your biggest challenge moving forward is?
Biggest challenge, biggest three challenges. Money. Volunteers, training, and to some lesser extent, making sure that we get a lease in place for our station, which we are negotiating right now, and a zoning special use permit approved by our village in order to be able to broadcast from the location we have in place.
So you're getting favorable support from the Huntley Village officials, yes?
Yes, actually, there is every organization that we've worked with, all the government officials, the government bodies, our civic organizations, the park districts, the other districts in the community, the library district, all have been extremely favorable to this coming to our community. And so we anticipate that there won't be any roadblocks on this effort in our part to be able to get that space. But the biggest challenge, they said, is obviously, as they talked about it, money. And we need to be able to...
Everybody's biggest challenge these days.
It is.
Everybody.
And so we're going to be going out to businesses, and there's about 100 that are located within the Huntley community that are based in Huntley that make over 100... over $1 million a year in sales.
God bless them.
$1 million a year. So it's even in this economy. So we're going to be targeting those businesses and then some philanthropic donors within the community. If you're listening, if your listeners are interested in participating in this this effort, we have a Facebook site.
Tell
us. It's facebook.com/ Huntley Radio. It's Huntley Radio combined. There's no blank in there. If you go to that site, you'll notice that in the tabs on the left sidebar of our page that we have a tab for make a donation, and they can certainly offer donations to us in any amounts, and we would truly appreciate that. And if they want to become volunteers on our station,
even the high school kids, internships, et cetera,
yes. Well,
correct?
Now, yeah, we talk about that. The high school is very much involved in that. The head of the speech department, the head of the journalism department is very committed to making this a part of their curriculum. And we are going to really offer this as an opportunity for kids that are interested in broadcasting, interested in journalism, start them early, and as a part of their curriculum, they will be developing their own. They'll be producing and broadcasting their own programming every day on our station.
Isn't that a wonderful opportunity for those kids?
I think it's going to be wonderful for them and community.
Tell me something. What qualities do you feel will make a good radio host?
Oh. To be honest with you, in our community, having a very, very positive attitude, being very balanced in there, in the way that they communicate to the audience. In other words, if they've got opinions, they really need to express that in a very balanced way. I do expect
balanced meaning
that they don't proselytize their particular point of view, but they're going to maybe bring up points of view that represent the community at large, and do that with by making sure that all viewpoints are brought together. That doesn't mean that we're going to be bland in our presentations.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's going to be positive, but we want to have some critical thinking going on. So there might be debates and so on, and that's it.
That'd be good for the kids. And, you know, ECC has a debate team. I bet you your Huntley High School has an awesome debate team that they could get on and practice.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you say that, because that is something which, we anticipate is going to happen. In fact, the speech department is at Huntley High School is well known for that, for their debating capabilities.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
What good practice for them.
Oh,
but
yes.
You know, one thing that's not debatable is that you are listening to the Laura Dion-Jones Show, and we are on the air with Alan Pollack, Executive Director and Founder of Huntley Community Radio, and Dorothy Litwin, one of Chicagoland TV and Radio's pioneer mavens. Back to the debatable team.
Yeah, so you heard about what our needs are in volunteers. Again, we use them in all different aspects of our operations. You know, if they want to be in studio hosts, they want to do remote broadcasts, that's great.
Keep me in mind if you have a position for Diva Lifestyle Advice Talk Radio.
We don't pay a lot.
Neither do they hear.
Laura's got a really good positive attitude. That's what you're looking for. She's always positive.
I am excellent with call-ins.
Yeah.
I love call-ins, but we don't encourage a lot of call-ins on this show because I only have 57 minutes.
Understand.
And a lot of times you have things you want to get across to make your time worthwhile. We want to entertain, but we want to inform our listeners, because the listener is number one.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Tell me what you think your strongest qualities are.
My strongest qualities?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, again, having been in the project management field before I retired, I think it's organizational skills, it's interpersonal skills, that my organizational skills, I kind of look at the development of this radio station as being another project.
Oh, sure.
You know, it's got
it's like a baby, though.
Challenges and so on, but nothing that seems to be unachievable. as long as we are able to go through the steps that are needed to get ourselves to the point where we can go on the air. The only stumbling block I anticipate at this point, other than, again, raising recruitment and money, is the FCC licensing. Again, we're looking to get to, this window is going to open up. We are going to apply for a construction permit. Basically, it says, you demonstrate you've got a location. We approve the location you're in. It's not going to apparently have any interference with surrounding stations mm-hmm. within the area, within the bandwidth that you're requesting. And then we I'm trying to think what the next thing. Anyway, is
anyway, you're on a good road, and you're on a good a good start, and it's past the embryonic stage.
It is.
I want to ask Dorothy something, because you have so much experience in the radio and TV industry, and you've met so many celebrities. Can you tell us about one of the most difficult celebrities you've ever worked with, and how you handled him or her?
Well, two things. After I left television and got married and raised four kids and worked with my husband, a CPA. There was a high school closing in Skokie for limited enrollment. They didn't know what to do with this 100,000 square foot building. So we had the idea of making it into a performing arts center. And it took a while, and we did. And I hired someone to be a director, and they were not very good. So I ended up being the executive director, which meant I had about 40 people working under me at one time, kind of the stage crew and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Booked all the programs, and I had to learn everything as I went along. Bought the advertising and the Tribune and that kind of thing. That was all very exciting. And most of the artists that we booked were really very, very pleasant. But one who was not very pleasant was Buddy Rich, the drummer.
No way!
Yeah. The audience wanted to come back, curtain call. Went back to his trailer and just wouldn't come back.
No encore,
I remember also Steve Allen, who's very tall. We didn't have much furniture in our dressing rooms, so we got donated these little couches?
Love seats.
Love seat. And I went down there to see if he needed anything, and here he's trying to take a nap on the love seat. His head was here and his feet were here. It was very funny. We had wonderful people, all of them. And we did everything from the well-known stars to some of the new comedians, big dance troupes, theater. We had and Gilbert and Sullivan, and I just can go on and on. And it was very, very exciting.
What do you think there's one secret to your success? What is it? If you could give me one secret.
My one secret.
I'm going to ask you next, so think.
I do know.
Tell me.
I don't care about earning money, and I love getting excited about something and developing it.
Yeah.
I developed the first Indian guides troupe when the kids were small in our area.
Good.
Yeah. And
I want to have adventure divas.
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe you can come with us. You interested? Are you in? We're going to go like zip lining in Lake Geneva.
I'm a little too old.
No, you're not.
How old?
I don't know how old, but you could.
I'm 86.
Well, you could
start to show
it. Handle it with the best of us.
But
bless you.
That's the thing I enjoy the most is developing, and that's why the radio station is very similar to the things I've done in the past.
Oh, you're a match
very
made
exciting.
In heaven for them.
Yeah, very exciting, and I love that. That's what I think is my biggest.
She's very young at heart. Absolutely young at heart.
I can see that.
She's the one who motivates me in our times when I might say, it's getting really challenging here, and she'll look at me and she says, well, we got to do this, this, and this. And the end result is that we, it kind of recharges me. But she is
Thank you.
Amazingly.
Boy, I wish I lived closer. I want to hang with you, Dorothy.
Yeah,
can I call you that?
Oh, absolutely. I'll call everything.
So tell me something, Alan.
Yes.
What do you think is your one secret to your success?
I look at very positively at almost everything. In fact, as a project manager, I was actually a director of project management at a point. The people that work for me, I looked at their positive sides. I tend to never look at their weaknesses, but focus on what is it that's their strengths. And I think people recognize that, and we work together. So I think my strength is that I'm a motivator. I am very positive about how I look. I don't back down from challenges.
And I
motivate other people to feel the same way.
Yeah.
So I really get people that are working with me on my side that mm-hmm. are maybe moving things forward.
I can relate. And I bet you do this also. You never ask someone to do what you wouldn't do.
Sometimes it's hard for me to delegate sometimes.
I know. I'm in the same shoes. Yeah. I'm in the same shoes. You got any regrets?
Not really. No.
Darts, do you have any?
No. Not at all.
Listen to these.
Well, I just lost my husband a month ago, so that.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah. We've been married over 60 years, so.
God bless.
Yeah. Yeah, God bless. Yeah.
So that's my only regret, that it couldn't have gone on a little longer.
Yeah.
Wonderful man.
Otherwise, life has been very good.
That's wonderful to hear. Listen, Alan, what would you like to leave our listeners with?
Think about our community radio station. Think about if you're not in our listening area, think about what community radio can do within your community, and think about that possibility of having something of its nature. I think that there is
Tuning into you on the internet.
And tuning into me into this station on the internet. That's right.
Where can people find you guys?
Well, at this point, we have yet to find our carrier, but we're going to let people know. We have a Facebook page. Within the next month, we're going to inaugurate a website. We'll inform people accordingly. When we actually get the FCC construction permit and we're licensed, we're hoping that our call letters are going to be WHCR, Huntley Community Radio.
Cool.
We can't
you get to pick your own? Like if I was going to do it, I could pick WLBJ?
Well, you know, you say that's WHCR is actually being used right now. There's a WHCR low-power FM frequency that has just been released by a station that didn't make it. And so I'm going to hope, but see, it's kind of the catch-22. We've got to get a construction permit and approval to demonstrate ourselves before we can get and a license
and
as a result
their,
of that in order to be able
letters,
to get that.
The call
and
letters.
The call letters, yeah, the caller WHCR and also the frequency, which in this area is we think it's going to be 101.5, but we can't
catchy.
Be sure.
Catchy, 101.5.
We don't know that yet. That's of course it's again.
This is Delilah.
Availability, yeah.
Laura.
So it's our hope. But just listen for more communications from us. We urge listeners who are in the capacity to do so to look to our station to either provide us some direction in terms of financial support, who they know, what companies would be able to provide us funding to make this happen for us, or to volunteer their efforts. To make the station a workable a venture for our community.
Hot dog. What do you want to leave our people with, our listeners with?
One thing everyone should know is that this new program that was passed by the Congress is going to create little stations like this all over the country.
That's wonderful.
You know, there's 700 right now. The closest one around here is in
Round Lake Beach.
Round Lake Beach, WLR. Yeah, they've been on 5 years.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
I want to thank Alan Pollack and Dorothy Litwin for being such wonderful guests today, and thanks for coming on the Laura Dion Jones Show. And what you're doing right now is listening to the Laura Dion Jones Show every Wednesday afternoon from 3 to 4 p.m. Central Standard Time on WRMN, 1410 a.m. Thank you, kids, for coming on. Stick around. We have to do pictures, sign the class book. I have a few words from another old favorite of ours, Jack LaLanne. Remember him?
Mm-hmm. Exerciser.
Yeah, he passed away last year on the 23rd of January. It'll be 1 year. And this is taken from an interview by Cal Fussman from August of 2004. Jack says, I have rules, and I follow them. No cake, no pie, no candy, no ice cream. Haven't had any in 75 years. It makes me feel great not eating birthday cake. That's the gift I give myself. Sure wish I could say the same. I live for birthday cake. Jack also says, when I was younger, I drank a quart of blood a day for about 6 weeks. I'd get it at the slaughterhouse. Yum. I heard about these...
Did help him?
Well, he
Did
says
he like
heard
it?
About these Maasai's in Africa. You know, those 7-foot-tall African guys. They drink cattle blood for strength. And then one day a little clock got stuck in my throat, and that was it for me. That would have been it for me, too. And if man makes it, I don't eat it, says Jack LaLanne. Go on, have a glass of wine with dinner. What is wine anyway? Pure grapes. A glass of wine is much better for you than a Coke. Not for me. I'm allergic to all alcohol, so give me a Coke. That's a diva saying that.
Yeah.
Jack says, any stupid person can die. Dying's easy. Living's a pain in the butt. I can't afford to die. It'll wreck my image.
Well
and it's that time again. We'd like to thank everyone for being with us today, my gang, Jeff, Mike, Valerie, the Swan, and of course, thank you to all of our loyal listeners, and thanks again to today's very special guests, Alan Pollack, Dorothy Litwin. Thank you so much for your time and for coming on the Laura Dion Jones Show. Next week on January 18th, some nice guitar music from Scott Bond and Kate Darling, who are opening a brand new guitar showroom here in downtown Elgin, and he's going to bring a guitar and show me how to play a little
Is that Fat Cat?
Fat Cat Guitars. Okay. They're coming in next week. And then Judson Librarian and Professor Lynn Hummerlin, who will tell us all about her appearance on Jeopardy the week of January 16th. So we're going to hear a big Jeopardy person. And today's show has been brought to you by
Dr. Claire Olais, 2001 Larkin Avenue.
And snobhounds.com, think Maggie meets Donna Karen, but for canines. And thanks again, Casey, for making this show possible. Please get everyone you know to read my blog at elgin.bocajump.com. And this is the Laura Dion Jones Show. I am Laura Dion Jones, and we absolutely love being here with you. You know we do. And Mikey, thanks for the happy. And now I want to tell you something. Donna Summer's going to tell us that she feels love. So Semper Fi, kids, and pray for peace.
This is Erin O'Connor, Miss Illinois 2009. To learn more about our program, please visit www.missillinois.org. You're listening to WRMN AM 1410 in Elgin.
The campaign says it raised 56 million.